try and make it specific to the band as well. So kind of titled it from fairly good to extremely good. I try to keep it as specific to the band as possible, but I'll already cross over as a little bit like the speaker before, come across into daily life. So it's quite a long session, so I split up into three main areas. Fairly good to extremely good in my view. So they're things that are in my view, especially in time, that are really important. Then more general leadership development off the court, and then some leadership development on the court. So perspective of a player, a coach, and maybe a manager managing a system as well. So a little bit of the who am I, so a good intro by Marianne. Welsh, British, not sure, there's a bit of confusion there. I had a big injury when I was 18, so I had a vascular necrosis on my hip, which is like osteoporosis. So I had a big operation when I was 18, I was out for a year, quite a big. Come back from that, former World of Seven, my injuries give me a good time to study. So I have degree in economics, MA in coach education from Bath Uni and MBA. And I guess all of that has kind of set me up quite well for my post-playing career. So I'm non-executive director of Badminton Europe and 4 years CEO in Ireland at Badminton and 1 year in Australia. So over the last year, it's been a real good learning curve of Australian sport with squash. Squash is an iconic sport in Australia, lots of success. But it does face a number of the same challenges that Badminton has. So through working through this, we've kind of developed a coach leadership program within squash that kind of works across all these areas. So that's where a number of these themes come across. So the first question is, like, what does it take to be world-class in anything? What does it take to be a world-class player, for example, in Bangkok? Same in any sport. Any traits that it takes to be world-class? Just
passion?
Yeah. So passion can be defined as, well, how do you define passion? How does that come across? It can be broken down. Number of hours you have to train for. Passion gives you the motivation to be able to do the hours. Any others?
Mental strength. Mental strength.
Yeah, mental strength. So again, comes back to maybe passion and motivation. Any others? One from this table? One more. In terms of world class, some of the traits you would need. So the former speaker hit a few of those. So passion.
Winning mindset, champion mindset.
Yeah, winning mindset, training environment, so all of those. So, motivation was my number one. Faith, hope, and love, so that's where you're having a stable home environment. So, having somebody that they can trust, rely on at home. General environment, the right people around them. Timing and patience, personal development. Self-awareness and resources. So, like those last couple of points are really coming into the leadership development section of how does a player develop themselves, like how self-aware are they in terms of how they train or what are they thinking, and then really the resources to enable them to develop. So I'm just going to drill down into those a little bit more. Motivation, so any definitions of motivation? Is there a condition or is there a prerequisite for world-class success? So if you have a world-class player, Olympic gold medalist, volleyball, badminton, are they born with motivation or is it something they develop through the system?
Is it very influenced by environment? Those they're around, those who aka parents, peers, coaches, idols,
so would you say it's more environmental? So if they're not born with it, it can be developed through their environment.
I think that's a big part of it. Yeah, that's what I said, a big part of it. And who knows what you're born with cognitively? We don't know yet, do we?
Yeah.
Which part of the brain would actually help?
Yeah. So a large
question.
Well, The expectation of a given effort leads to a desired performance. So you put all the effort in, otherwise you need the passion to do the effort to get the performance. The expectation then is the given performance leads to a reward that is considered valuable. Hence, when both of those are positive, you have motivation. So the effort of the desired performance and the value of what you're doing gives you motivation. So if it's an environmental, it's prerequisite. Term, but you need both of those to be able to gain motivation. Faith, hope, and love. So again, you won't find many world-class athletes that don't have a very stable base, a confidence in where they come from or what they do, and that can be gathered from somebody that has faith in them. Somebody they see as being knowledgeable, so it could be a coach, it could be parents, someone that can show them a way, could be a system, and a confidence that someone will still have value in them if they lose. So if a player doesn't have lots of those, it can lead to unstable characteristics. They can miss a point at a big part of a match, which costs them a tournament. They won't be able to focus and train day to day. They won't be able to gain a passion. So again, they're prerequisites for, I guess, the center of an athlete. In terms of the environment, again, every sport, but for badminton, there could be a club involved, there could be a national team, a circle of acquaintances, and at home. So within a club environment, what can be the positives and negatives of club environment for a young athlete, 14 years old. Any positives and negatives?
Inclusion would be a positive. Being excluded would be somewhat non-constructive.
Yeah. So behaviors of others. So in every club there'll be variables. There'll be some good athletes that set a good example. There'll be some negative ones that set a negative example. They're kind of everywhere. So club. How do you make it a positive environment? Why is some a positive environment? Why is some a negative environment? What's the key denominator in that?
It's the ethos of the club. It comes down to, you can either make it all welcoming for youngsters to come in and everybody accepts them and helps them, or you can have a dysfunctional club where actually youngsters aren't to be welcome. You know, a percentage might welcome them, but a percentage not, and then of course that gives a negative attitude to it from there.
And that could be largely that ethos is maybe set by a few key influences in the club.
Yeah.
So how a club is run, parents can have a positive impact on that club, how they behave with the coach, how they impact on the club. So that environment can be controlled to a certain extent. National team, daily training, the same. You know, you have good daily training systems around the world, bad ones. It's important that the player has world-class daily training. And there's ways we can interact with that. Circle of acquaintances, so coaches, friends have an impact on a player's development. So again, understanding how those work and providing the player with the right personal development skills to be able to decide what's a good environment for them, who are their friends, who aren't their friends. So it's really empowering the athletes to help them develop those skills themselves. So further on from that, in terms of the right people around the athlete, who are the closest people to the place? So coaches, parents. So start with parents. How can parents be a positive or negative to the player? This would be average.
Feel their attitude.
Yeah.
Are they supportive?
Yeah.
Dismissive. Will they take training, you know, living in that positive encouragement? Will they actually push them too far, living their lives through them?
And how are they positive? Because you won't find a world champion in the Western world that hasn't had parents that would drive them around from the age of 6 and pay for everything up until they're 18 and get funding. So parents are, you know, can be a real positive. So how can we have parents there as one of the... We need to educate them. We need to work with them and link with them. So what type of things can we do to work with parents to improve their we want to keep it on the positive side, not the negatives. So what type of things can we do to engage as a coach, as a system?
I think I tend to have like an honest relationship with them, so you know, be realistic expectations and demands being placed upon the child and what they can do to support them, and to make sure they're actually working with me, not against you.
So again, build relationships and help establish those relationships. And in terms of, I guess, mechanisms in a system, what can help develop those relationships? What type of things can we do as a system at the state, at the club, at national, to help educate parents and develop those relationships? Anybody else, any other mechanisms we can use to develop those relationships for parents?
Get the parent involved.
Yeah, parent involved and communication, probably the two. So you can communicate via websites, e-learning systems, interactive sessions to provide courses for parents to get them involved, improve communication, and actually get them involved. So if it's, it's a club, try and get them involved on the court with maybe a group of younger players away from their own child, try and get them involved. If you're a squad, you have 20 parents. As a coach, you can't really talk to all those parents at one time, but you know, designate one parent to act as a kind of spokesperson for the 20 and let them take that communication to the group of parents so that you're getting that feedback in a manageable way. Not speaking to 20 people at the same time, but try and filter the feedback back to you. So again, try and find ways of communicating.
Is that what you're doing, is identifying the parents that are going to be able to influence in a constructive way to other parents?
Yeah, I think if you leave parents to their own devices, ultimately a lot of them can lead to a negative. So don't leave them to their own devices. So you have to find ways of engaging them. Depends how many parents. If it's one-to-one, it's easy to talk to the parents. But if it's a group, then you need to find a mechanism for talking to the parents and trying to engage them on a mass scale. You know, the closer you can be to the parents and communicate around the concerns, try and give them the side of the club, the state, or the national body, then the better that relationship's going to be, and educating them alongside that. Because a lot of the things are quite complicated.
Sure.
Trying to empower them to make coaches, obviously really essential around players. What type of things can you do for coaches?
Their education, their experience.
Workshop. Engagement, again, trying to communicate, to provide them latest information, coaches accreditation, register systems, all the same mechanisms. And then that leads to the third point, which is really the coach, player, parent type of training in terms of making sure that communication. So if a player is given a set of skills to make sure that the parents are aware of what their child is working on in the next period and making them feel involved in terms of the development process. By having firm boundaries in where they are in that frame, it might be different child to child, but it's a lot easier to develop a young player if you have a parent on the side that can take them away from that weekly session and make sure they're working on the skills every day of the week at home, if they're doing visualization, whatever area they work on. While a child is growing up, parents can be really valuable to them. Third one was friends. So friends can be really positive, they can be slightly negative. Especially elite young players, they don't lead a normal life. So their friends might struggle with that. So again, being able to talk and have some education with young players around, you know, how life works, explaining how they can communicate with their friends, how they can manage their time to keep a normal life, and develop their own personal skills so that they're able to work that out for themselves is key. And look at on that next. And then the third one, then for all the players, is really call the entourage around that, agents, advisors, mental coaches. So again, communication, trying to involve everybody where possible, trying to educate. So in terms of timing, the importance of timing, there's loads of kind of garden metaphors for that. So kind of sowing seeds of current crop. And they use garden metaphors because of the immutability of time, or the you can't get past time and how long it takes to grow something. So kind of the Chinese bamboo of, you know, it's a little shoot and then it grows to 3.5 meters long. So trying to get across in the development cycle for players to be patient when need be. I guess in some cases recognize when is the next kind of, when is the important cycle to move to another group, to be impatient. So trying to communicate as a coach, as a manager, why we plan something a certain way, how long it's going to take, so that we can provide players with a way of setting their goals within a deliverable timeline. So like previous speaker, have your goals, but have a timeline, have a medium set goal, have small goals, so that you're getting from one step to another step. In the same way, if you're working on development areas with a young player, you could start with the one with the highest effect first, to get their motivation going, to make them passionate. You could give them something, some early success in something, before you really delve down into something you know they're going to struggle. So you give them some success, you work on a real development area, and then you might go back to something successful to keep them motivated at the end of the summer. So that timing and how you tackle those goals is essential. In terms of personal development, so this is how players deal with their friends, how they deal with actions in everyday life. Having a player understand as early on who they are and why they play badly is pretty essential. You know, their life can't be just about badminton. They can't see themselves as just the result of badminton. So it's important early on to try and tackle those questions by reflection and, you know, open questions rather than closed questions. So I think we should question early in the previous session around, is it your or his, their dream if they want to be good? You know, ultimately it has to be their dream, but they have to understand why, and they have to be able to understand what it means behind that. So I think that's a really essential piece, which if you don't have in place, players won't have the passion, they'll lose the motivation at different stages of their growth cycle. From puberty, teenagers, adulthood, you know, if they're all difficult periods, and a player really understanding why they train, why they play badminton, and what their goals are, and having them choose their goals will help them tackle those difficult phases, if you like. It provides them the motivation, it provides them the skills to interact with coaches and parents and other players. And an essential part of that is our reflection skills as coaches, so being able to coach in a reflective way, which I'll next. So following on from that, players, when they're reflective, they'll ask questions as coaches of what are their strengths. They need to recognize what they're good at, so they can keep that, but then also recognize what their weaknesses are, so they can develop plans for that. They need to think about and feel, I guess, what their inner thoughts are. How do they feel inside? If they get negative feedback, how do they respond to that negative feedback? And the biggest thing is they need to be able to put everything into perspective. So they need to be able to react in the right way to any information and feedback. And that's about the reflective skills. And coming back to why do they play badminton? What do they want to get out of the badminton? And the 15-year journey between, do they understand all the processes in it? Having said all of that, there's some basic resources that you need to be a world-class player. Anybody name me one or two resources that you need ultimately? So if you have a player that is motivated and has great development skills, what other?
Peter Dosh.
Radosh, yeah, number one. You get the max points.
It's a book.
So there's three.
Good
books.
Book of the week.
Yeah, you need coaches or access to knowledge and...
Access is probably the right one. So to get access, you time, you know, you need the time to get to the coach, you need to get time to get back. You know, you've got life, school, education. So you've got somebody that motivated, wants to be good, has really good learning capacity, money, time, and something else they need.
People.
No, I can fit that one in time. It's a good one. One more.
Facilities.
Money. Get you facilities, don't worry about that. I get really cheap on money. Talent. So there needs to be an element of talent. So they have the motivation, they have the personal development skills. And you can have a separate discussion on what talent is. But generally in this context, it's a congenital capacity to be able to be particularly good in a particular skill. Which with badminton helps to be world class because you can develop the array of skills you needed. It's a complicated sport. It's not just a straight line sport. You know, for badminton you need to be physically really fit, you need lots of different skills. So having the talent and the ability to take skills on quickly helps. And then the motivation and all the self-development as well. I guess the first sign of a young player beginning to think is one of the first questions they'll ask is how long does it take to become really good? So, and I guess the general answer is it'll take a lot longer than what they want at a young age. Especially for a sport like badminton, how many world champions do you know that started playing when they were 17 or 18? Okay. Now the sports that are world champions that start playing at 17, 18. So, trying to get that across to the wider entourage, parents, people around, and also even young players coming through, it takes quite a long time of developing lots of different skills. So what you can do in that is break down the skills. So if you're working on a particular net player, you can say, you have goals within 3 months, 6 months to develop a certain area. And you're continuously evaluating those areas to make sure that they're improved. But being able to address elements of time and how long it will take to get good is essential.
Richard, good question for you.
Yeah.
In your experience, you know, as you were developing as an athlete, did you know that you were going to be a world-class player, top 10 player? What was in your mind, and did your coach or coaches help you develop that as well?
Yeah, I think, again, looking back, without thinking about it at the time, I think the coaches I worked with helped me develop a sense of where I wanted to be, which is generally the best what I did, so to be the best at badminton. But they set me mini goals of along that process of being initially the best in Wales, best in UK, best in Europe at different ages. And specifically they give me skills across being the best at a particular skill set, the best at the physical component. So in my younger days, I had one of the best fitness profiles in terms of VO2 max amongst all the Welsh athletes across all sports. So they were able to give me like measurables working with the sports science team so that it was all of those things individually added up to make me a world-class athlete. It wasn't one thing. So yeah, they didn't set, obviously I wanted to be the best in the world, but it was broken down into lots and lots and lots of different goals, which I'll come on to a little bit. And the most important prerequisite from a young player, from a coach, from anybody is the ability to learn. So lots of world champions aren't born with champions. They might be born with skill, talent, they might be passionate, but even the most talented have to put in a lot of work. And those that aren't so talented, I wasn't so talented, have to do lots and lots and lots and lots of work. So you just have to work harder to be able to achieve. So one example I've got is relevant is Tina Rasmussen from Denmark. So I've chosen Tina because Tina's the same age as me, so I know her quite well. She's within the Danish system. Danish system is very good. I'm trying to explain why a little bit. And Tina had lots of challenges through her career. Tina was also not the most talented player in the world, but she ended up winning the Super Series and being world number one. She's not a bad athlete.
Thank you.
Yeah,
it's all good now.
So, I think to win this with a little bit about my background, again, same age, you can do this for any player, and you probably have a similar life story of some of the complications. And trying to understand some of the complications and then the path and the growth helps explain maybe why a system tries to achieve what it does. As a coach, you need to understand it isn't a straight line development curve for a player. You know, it's up and down, up and down. So, Tina, same age, European number one, same as me. That's when she went into the national team as number eight in Denmark. So I got injured at the same time though for a year. 2000, she just got into the Danish Cup U Cup team, so that's the fourth singles, so not playing, but part of a really good system. Camilla Martin was in the team, so really good role models around them, really good coaches involved. The team Denmark system would have psychology and sports science that she could benefit from. So, within the same time, I was really outside the system. So I found what was best for me here in the Netherlands. I lived in Denmark for 3 or 4 years on and off. Qualified for the Olympics, I was world number 16, European bronze medal. 2002 was world number 7, bronze medal in Commonwealth Games, beat a number of world champions, world number ones. But again, I wasn't part of the system. So I was lucky enough to learn off lots of good individuals within the system, but I wasn't part of the system. At the same time, Tina follows a much more slower improvement curve. But it was probably too slow for the Danish team. So in 2003, she had a crisis meeting that was part of the annual reviews where they came up with a number of development goals for her because she wasn't on track to be world number one where the Danish team wanted her. So they changed her game a little bit. They made a weight reduction plan for her. I need one of those now. And they tried to make an injury plan for her because she had a series of bad Achilles issues. And they set her a small term goal of qualifying for the Olympics. So not winning a medal, just qualifying for Athens. At the same time, I'd been out for 2 years, I come back and was playing around the same window. So then within Tina's plan, she basically, within the 1 year, she met her weight goals. So she slimmed down a little bit. She was never overweight, she was just tall. And with the weight power, the weight ratio, she can't carry so much weight on for so long. So she really did trim down. She changed her playing style. So she's very tall. So they changed her technique to make use of her slices, her smashes, and her angles, and then to dominate the net. So again, the Asian players weren't used to that type of style. So it's really to maximize her height. So that was a lot of thinking and a decision on her part to change. And she qualified for the Olympics. So that was her base goal. And if you compare, we came from the same place. I remember in the 2000, I'd already been world number 16, I won medals. And she was on a much slower increase. I qualified for 2004, but I had glandular fever. I played with glandular fever, and then I was ill for 2 years with different things. So again, not part of the system as such. So Tina then starts some gradual improvements. She starts dating the Danish physio. She was in the physio so much, injured a lot. And that basically just speeded up her injury prevention plan. Generally all around, seemed to help her development. She reached the semi-final of China Open in 2004. So she was like 25, 26 there. So, she's getting into the world top 10 around there, top 15. 2005, she ruptured Achilles, so she was out for 9 months. So that's a big a negative for her. 2005, they made a recovery plan with a physio. And she comes back at the end of the year and wins the first tournament. I think it was a challenger, a lower grade tournament. And in 2006, makes some improvements, quarterfinal of the Europeans. But again, suffering with tonsillitis and a number of other small illnesses. At the same time, I started back from illness, and I got to world 25 in that 2 year period. So you can see that Tina's sort of improvement has really gone up and down a little bit.
It's been quite a gentle curve. She started from quite a high place, but she's been within a really good system. So even though her outcomes are maybe not amazing, what she's done in that time is she's got used to the training volume and being able to train at high intensity. The quality of her training across the period are being excellent. The one thing they do really well in Denmark is the quality of everything is really good, and it's kind of grounded into all the coaches throughout the system. She's got excellent knowledge of the game, excellent knowledge of physios and everything else around that. She's having a stronger body. So all the base of the triangle, all the foundations have been built really well. And that's been focused on for 7 years, not 7 weeks or 7 days. They then look at her goals setting, which is a little bit like a previous setting. They create a cheat goal ranking. So the cheat goal ranking was basically taking out the number 4, 5, 6 Chinese, taking out players that were going to retire in the next year or two. I think there was a few players retiring around that stage. And they set her a target of trying to get to world number one on a cheat ranking. So that gave her motivation. She then had a year of no interruption to her training because of injuries and illness, because of the previous 7 years. And at the end of 2007, or August 2007, she got quarterfinal of the world champs and then won the Japan Super Series 4. And that was really the start of some success for her. She won all England, Singapore Super Series, medals at Europeans. Had a bad 2008 Olympics, but kind of rebounded back to the Super Series and got world number one later in that year. But by then she's 30 years old, around 20, 29. So you can see it takes an awful long time to get to that. And that's on top of Tina would have started when she was 10, got to the national team at 18, and then 29, she's world number one. So that takes an awful long time. Back to the question of how long does it take of really good training, good quality training to get to where she is. Okay. In terms of a goal setting, this is the type of things to work on. So they'd have a dream goal. They'd have a real goal. And then they would have a success criteria. So a world ranking was top 5, ideally, but the minimum would be top 10. And it would be successful to be top 20. So this is in 2007, before her success. The main goals really come off, so the development goals. So the main primary goal was not to get ill or injured, because she had 8 years of injury illness. And the real benchmark for her in that year was being able to keep everything together on top of everything she built up. Then they had a mental goal, a movement goal, and then some specific badminton goals. So increased shuttle control, better tactical sense. On the next page was to be the best in the world women's game at the net and the most dangerous attack. So again, with her height, you know, the control of the back of the court and the control of the front of the court really made her really dangerous to play against. She then had the fitness of not having any interruptions in the training, so that those three together made her a very dangerous opponent. Then her weakness areas were her defense, so she focused on her defense to make sure that that was as good as it could be, and then added in variation. So the choice is all straight net spin and cross net. So again, that made her attack even more dangerous. And at the end of that period, they would get evaluated in terms of regular performance appraisal. So that type of mechanism really, I think with Tina, was a really good example of how long it took for her to develop. Some of the pitfalls, some of the difficulties that she went through, and how the Danish system, sports system help players kind of get through those and reach greater heights and you know, in a different way than say in China or in other sports. So some of the pitfalls there, can anybody give me some examples of pitfalls of what not to do? So we see the Danish system there, you can see the quality of training, the level of expertise that are helping here, the time involved. Is there anything that you generally, some big things that you wouldn't do in terms of a system? So that could be as a coach with your players, as a system working with the different levels. Any no-nos?
Just
Yeah, it depends on the goals and aspirations, but how they are. Specifically within the training. So if you're on board with a player, what are some of the most important, what's the most important thing when you're on board?
Overtraining?
Yeah. And I guess overtraining.
Training when they're injured.
Yeah. So overtraining, training when they're injured means that the practice isn't perfect. So if you do lots and lots and lots and lots of practice, it doesn't really make you perfect. Lots of practice makes you constant, or your shot selection permanent, so you don't make mistakes. So you see lots of players, you see this everywhere, doing lots and lots of training, and they're a bit miserable and they're not happy. That tends to make them permanently miserable. And poor exercise makes you constantly poor. So everything you do, so it might be off-court, weight training, so plyometrics, you know, it has to be done with a player wanting to do it, and there has to be an element of quality to everything they do. On court, everything has to have quality. Again, in Denmark, they do that annoyingly well. So they have a big emphasis within the coaching structure, within the system of perfect exercises, everything being perfectly executed. It might not be all the time, but they have a focus on trying to ensure it is as much as it can. And the idea being that the longer you train within a perfect state, the better it makes you. If you train a very, very long time in the perfect way, then it makes you very, very good. So you're talking about if you're doing 2 against 1, if you can keep the perfect exercise going for 30 seconds where you're spinning, you're using variation, the tempo is good, you're not making mistakes, then if 90 seconds is as long as you can do it, then you do it for 90 seconds. Or you try to do it for 1 minute, 40 seconds. You don't do 15 minutes and then it kind of falls down and lots of mistakes and it breaks down. Then you're kind of moving away from the quality. You get some fitness element, but you're moving away from the quality. And yeah, if you're Peter Gay or Lin Dan, Lee Chong Wei, you can do it for 15 minutes for perfect quality. But you start off at a manageable scale and you slowly build up to that level and volume of training. The next one is, like, the same way in the psychology of the player of the motivation. Athletes who seek out problematic improvements rather than avoid them will be more successful. So, you know, if a player is training miserable, then they'll be miserable. If somebody is training too much, they'll make a mistake. So you want to keep your players as motivated as possible. And as coaches, you have to find the right prescriptive way with each player of doing that. So no player is the same. But you need to try and keep the players as focused as possible to try and get them a positive outcome. So that has led to the phantom section. So what I'd like to do now is just give you a few, I guess, in the groups you're in, just to move on to a full reflection leadership models that try to explain ways of engaging with young players, try and explain ways of engaging with has anybody heard of learning cycle? Basic learning cycle? Like stages of learning, so.
So as in unconscious incompetence?
Yeah, unconscious incompetence. Yeah. Basic ones.
Yeah.
What about in terms of if you learn something, so you learn a forehand smash, what are the stages of that? What are the four basic stages of that?
And what I just said, there's two more.
Yeah, think of more basic, so that's really the next level, I guess, I think. You play the shot, so that would be kind of a concrete experience of trying. So if you want to improve that shot, what is the way of reflecting on that to improve that shot? So it you want to improve
the shot. So
hand that over.
Analyze,
yeah. So analyze, you're like reflecting. So you're looking at what worked, didn't work, you know.
So, are you saying like with the learning cycle, like you receive information?
But it might be self. It might be self-learning.
Yeah.
So
there's some form of you receiving information.
Yep.
And then there's some sort of application of the information.
Yep.
And then you've got to do some sort of analysis and reflection.
Yep.
which is pretty much perfect, yeah. So you have the concrete experience, you reflect on how that smash was done, you would then learn from the experience by the coach or outcome, and then you would plan or make a variation for the next attempt. So this is the part that's good. So this is sort of just, if you pick a shot, a skill, I'll give you 5 minutes just to think about it, and just make a plan for how to develop that skill within that learning cycle. So for example, say you talked about smash, what type of exercises would you do to see the outcome of the smash? How would the reflection, as a coach, how would the reflection process be led with the player? What type of things would you do to conceptualize the improvement of pull? And how would you plan that out to develop a shot? You can choose your own shot, but just give it a very simple mini bullet point cycle in terms of how would you think about that. That makes sense. Give me 2 minutes.
In 2 minutes.
Groups or individuals within your team. So if you're happy with
group.
So give me a hand. Your hand is semi up.
I was trying.
It's above your shoulders. It's above your shoulders. So anybody just give a shot that is developing and just some brief high level learning curve development. Volunteers.
We were halfway through.
Go on. Yep.
So we have, first of all, we were watching to see how his backhand is going.
Yep.
So we've observed that he's not able to hit it in the designated area.
Yep.
And he's doing it 4 out of 10. Then we reflected on how we could help him out. So maybe the way he approaches the shot, with the racket head, using the racket head versus using the arm to move the racket head.
Yep.
And then third, we were just coming onto that part now, which is what exercise we were going to put up for it. So that's the first one.
Okay. The third is the conceptualization.
Conceptualization, yeah.
So, anybody on their ones, what do you have anything for that?
The second, the same in reverse form.
Point, okay, you got it. Okay, so conceptualization could be asking the players questions around what they're doing, open-ended questions are better than closed, trying to help them define if there was something on the drive or backhand, the right technique, maybe studying, depending on the level of players, and visualization, so that they can work on the right shot off the court, so that they can, before they go to bed, they do chemistry visualization, they can see the shot every day. Again, maybe working with parents, so parents can kind of reinforce that. Fourth one, experimentation and planning. So make a bit of a mini plan, so you don't want to do the same thing all the time. So it might be talking around some multi-shuttle technique, some
progression,
games, conditioning games, and just making a bit of a mini plan for how you can take it from step one to step 10. So generally in the right direction. Again, what you're trying to do there is try and have more of a growth mindset rather than fixed. So fixed is good, because fixed can make improvements in the short term, but it limits growth long term, where growth mindset can have more of a long term, it's more holistic, it can make players organically develop, and it'll have a longer term impact at the higher level. Okay? So you're trying to encourage that type of growth thinking. So alternative to growth is fixed. Anybody give me an example of a fixed mindset?
Just going to ask you, what do you mean by fixed plan versus
if you want to say really
difficult plan that we actually use?
Classic example is I can't do maths. And a fixed mindset implementation is that you can't do maths yet, and that you're trying to instill in a student that every facet of life is fluid, it's not fixed.
Yeah.
So you're trying to move away from I can't do something to you haven't done it yet.
But that's essentially what we do, but that's one of the
So within a coaching context, for example, if you're going to teach forehand spinet, okay, inside out or outside in, whichever one,
and if you teach your player one way of doing, say you just teach one, you just do outside in, like forehand net, and you only teach that way, that's an example of a fixed mindset, because you're only teaching the one way, because you make assumptions that that's the best way, and then you'll work into the next one. So you make a number of assumptions that that's the best shot, which is on the next slide, so we'll come on to that. So fixed mindset, generally avoid challenges. With players, it can mean if they give up early on an activity, because they're frustrated or demotivated. They don't see their efforts as being rewarding. They don't take negative feedback in the right way, so they don't look at development opportunities in the right way. Generally, fixed mindset would be threatened by other people. So you see it a lot of time. I've experienced training in a lot of different training centers around the world. And in some centers, the other players would be very defensive of playing. You play against them, they would like try, you know, they figure out. It's a waste of time for everyone. And you go to another training center, and everybody would give 110%. Even if they were a little young, you get much better training from being in that environment. And going back to Denmark again, the entire system there is built on a growth mindset. So they don't really allow the fixed mindset to even exist within the system. So if you don't try, or if you're not given 100%, you get kicked out quite early on, and it doesn't matter if you're a world junior champion or any level. So they try to encourage a growth mindset throughout every level of the system. So growth, embrace change. So not threatened by change, because they maybe want to understand change more and they're kind of happy with where they are. Persistent in the face of setbacks, so they're not concerned if something goes wrong in the short term, because they see the bigger picture. They take a step back, and it's almost like you're in a helicopter looking down over all the ground. You're not fixed in one field looking at leaves on a branch. So you have a much higher view of everything, and you understand how everything works. So you're a lot more empowered by your own skill and your own knowledge.
The bigger picture mindset rather than that.
Yeah, so more that fits into the growth. They see all the effort and work that has to be done going in a path one way or the other. So it's not maybe a player could be world champion or fail. It's a player could be world champion, they can be the best Australian at the Olympics, they can go to university, they can just keep a healthy lifestyle for life, and then they go and work in a bank and they want some money. So there's no, like, they have to be world champion or fail. There's probably 100 different pathways. And the journey of trying to be Olympic gold medalist is the key. So it's the journey of developing self-development skills, motivation, passion, are all transferable into all your other day jobs, whatever you do. So you'll find that a lot of successful athletes are equally successful in their careers afterwards, because they've developed all of those core skills that are transferable. So it's the journey of being trying to be world champions in court, not the actual outcome of if you actually win a gold medal. That's, you know, that's losing the message in translation. So when you're working with young players, you're trying to develop all those skills we looked up front, trying to explain the importance of time, personal development, self-awareness skills, and trying to focus on those, not if they end up winning a gold medal in 20 years, because it'll take 20 years. And really finding lessons and inspiration in the success of others to try and inspire. So that's the same story. As a result, they'll generally achieve higher levels across everything they do in school, in work, and in sport.
It's interesting, because it runs on what we were talking about earlier, is how do you, if the person doesn't reach their dream goal or whatever you want to call it, then how are they going to survive after? And that's, I think this really does not leave them stranded. They will just go, well, that wasn't my way, but I can be successful in business banking, whatever you want to say.
Exactly. And
that's
if you go to Denmark again, I used to live in Denmark. I find Denmark very annoying now, and I have to say good things about it. But so many of my friends that are the same age as me, they're Danish, number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. None of them like achieve what they wanted to do, but they're all international private bankers, finance, economists, international real estate
operators.
And sport set them up in a really good way from an educational point of view.
Can you solve it then?
Hmm?
Can you solve it?
No, I'll try not to.
But there's one.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Yeah.
What is Shankri?
What's that name?
Shankri.
Shankri. Yeah. Shankri, well, the one. Yeah, two
suicide. Why is it suicide?
Yeah. Well, I think in every example, I think people have personal issues in the life that swing a left ball, you know, and everybody has personal issues. So you're basically taking a general example, and I think I don't know if this meant to be an example, but again, that was pre the Team Denmark system and the Danish system I'm talking about. He was involved before then, and probably would have suffered from a lot of the things they've tried to happen. Quite possibly their system is a result of what happened, you know, in terms of their former athletes weren't looked after. So, as an example, one of the programs we're working on, and probably Badminton as well, is a kind of a transition program for athletes. So when athletes are finishing playing, as in Squash Australia, we're investing quite a lot of money in finding them a mentor in any business line they're working. We have a coach leadership program with Melbourne Business School to give them this type of training. We try to keep them involved as coaches, so we pay for their formal coach education. But if they're not involved in coaching, we try to make sure they have a connection with the sport at a board level or whatever level they are. So we try to make a prescriptive program around every retiring top athlete to help them develop into kind of back into normal life. Because as I said, athletes are at the high level, in a very fake glass bubble that isn't real. So we have to have very important mechanisms and education as they go into that. So that's kind of junior system, 12 to 16, and then mechanism for when they come out of that at 30 plus. Mm. So that's kind of what we're trying to do. That's what they're trying to do. Okay. Yeah. So jumping ahead, this is one of the things you mentioned, the Jomori window, which is the model of top left, is basically kind of understanding yourself. And it comes back to one of the first slides of players. And do they understand themselves? And do they know why they play? It's called Jomori window, and it's really about knowing what you know about yourself and knowing what others think of you. It doesn't have to be good or bad, but just understanding other people's perceptions. Then the bottom left is hidden self, which is what's known to you, but unknown to others. So there might be development areas or anything that you know you need to work on, but others don't. Blind self is the top, right? Which is unknown to you and unknown to others. So the kind of unexplored areas. And the unknowing self is the bottom right. Information about you that others know that you know. So, generally, you know, that kind of covers everything one way or the other. It's a really simple model. And generally what you would like in the perfect world to do is to try and increase, my blue line is a really bad example of trying to increase the size of that open self box. So if you improve your development skills and you improve in as a manager, as a coach, as a player, you basically increase the size of that open self box. And that's generally helpful in lots of ways. And by doing that, you reduce the blind self, the known self, and the hidden self. Okay, so it's a really simple model, but it's a good way of explaining what you're trying to do with young players and as a coach. So you're trying to capture as much information that is out there, and then you're trying to decipher it and make a plan for it. It might be good, it might be bad. But if it's bad, you know, develop opportunities, you want to try and work on them and improve them. And if it's good, it's good to know the good things. But you want to limit the amount of unknown knowledge out there. Okay? And from that information, you'll make a number of assumptions, which is fine, but you need to get as much information as possible to make assumptions about, and then you need to become more educated. So you make less assumptions, and you actually are able to take the information in. Another good example, same, it's very similar. If there's a problem between a coach and player, coach, you have the information in the purple box, which is the information that you know about the situation. You have information in the green box, which is the other person, and trying to understand the issue from their side. The blue box is, maybe if it's a coach issue, the blue box would be the National Federation or State Federation, so looking at it from an outside perspective, how do they see the issue? And then the red, the observer box, and again, is maybe somebody removed from the sport, so maybe a commission or individual on the street. Trying to understand kind of what they see of the situation. And by trying to get an idea of all those different viewpoints, you're better informed to keep your viewpoint or slightly change your viewpoint, but you have a lot more information and data from which to make a decision. So any decision you make is going to be better for the more information you can gather. Generally on everything, you don't have to change your mind, and it might just reinforce what you're deciding, but the more information that you can gather, the more evidence you're going to have for why you make the decision. So a good example of this is pool of variable data at the bottom, so ladder of interference. Then you basically select that data, you make some assumptions around the so-called assumptions. It's maybe you miss some aspects, or you take something for granted that a young player can't smash on. So that you kind of gloss over some things. You then make some conclusions. That's a conclusion I just made. You then form a belief that the young player can't smash hard, and he needs to practice his slices instead because it can't smash. And then you would then develop a plan to improve their slicing. So in that example taken to the bottom, the pool of data would be all your coaching knowledge, all your formal coaching, your mentoring, your previous playing experience, everything that's available to you. You select from that data what you want to select. If you're a fixed mindset, you'll select a very small percentage. If you're a growth mindset, you'll select more. You'll then make a number of assumptions, maybe because you don't understand some area, maybe because you disagree with some things, but you gloss over some things. You make a conclusion about what the outcome needs to be, and that forms part of your belief and part of your coaching philosophy, and then you'll coach on the back of that process. And then you'll start the process again via reflection. So you reflect on the outcome, and you go back to your data selection. That makes sense. Good question on this table was about the coach. So that was in a coach's context. In a player's context, it would be the same. It's just, what would be the difference between a coach's diagram and a player's diagram? If you look at that diagram, if you're a coach, so that's the coach. What's the difference between that and how a player would go through the same process? So say a player doesn't have a coach and then playing a tournament and they need to improve the smash. What's different between that for a player and a coach?
The data's reduced perhaps, but the rest stays the same.
Yeah. So same process. It's just the actual pool of data would possibly less because they have less experience. Depends on the player, depends on the coach, but possibly the pool of data is smaller. So another good model is above and below the line. So, like feeding on from that, really simple model by Weekly. Anyway. So above the line is more task oriented. So do this, do that, rules, regulations. So that would be more something with a fixed mindset. And then below the line is something more relationship related. So that would be trying to understand why people do something, trying to motivate people, trying to get passion, trying to create an identity for a sport or a team division. So there are things where you're actually kind of in a growth mindset. Okay. So above the line is task, and below is growth. As a coach, you need to be probably working in both, above and below. Can somebody give me an example of an above the line way of coaching? So, what's an above the line method of coaching?
The certain more pieces for the set.
Huh?
Yeah. There's certain more pieces for above the line, below the line.
Yes?
You know this, right?
So just the last section is, again, just trying to relate that back to that one. Okay? So when you have a player going into the Danish system at 18, like in reference to any player in any national system, they would have an increased level of mobility. Okay? So they kind of go into the system, it's kind of uninformed optimism. They then have to train really, really hard, or they have to move away, or any of those hard things, and then they have kind of an informed pessimism at the bottom, where it becomes really tough. Okay? So time's going sideways, and their mood is on the up axis. They then might get some success, they might become more informed, they see some improvements, so they become more of an informed optimism, and then they complete the task, they improve, they win at the tournament, and the cycle kind of starts again, or they get the desired outcomes. So again, within a system point of view, if you take
a very faint red line.
So
there's a blue line at the bottom which you can barely see.
So in a system that's less developed, if you go back to Lenconi's system of trust, focus on results, commitment, if it doesn't have that, the curve can go quite deep. Okay? So if a player comes into a system of doesn't really see the outcome, isn't becoming informed, then it can go further down. Then the upward line can take longer, and maybe it doesn't go as high. So that's within a system that's dysfunctional in terms of Lenconi's model. Alternatively, there's now a really thin red line. If it's a good system that kind of thrives and has good leadership, then you can turn around the informed pessimism quite quick. You can motivate people, you can create that passion, you can educate them. And then basically their outcome will be faster and bigger. And I think the Danish system is a really good example of that. And in Australia's sport, quite the swimming system. But basically they're all working off the same goal. So just in terms of training, how it can be different. You've got learning tasks, and then you've got performance tasks. So learning tasks is where you're trying to develop a player's self-development, trying to develop their learning skills. Performance is where you want a performance outcome at the tournament and you want the results to be good. And they're slightly different things. So learning tasks, more away from tournaments, trial and error, variability, they're comfortable and they can maybe slightly lower outcomes initially. They can be confusing as they work on new skills. The tasks need to be kind of work on differently every time to give variation. It's kind of an area of exploration and adaption, but ultimately in the long term will provide more tools, better quality of shots. As you come nearer the tournaments, you're focusing more on performance, so it's familiar drills, consistency, a stable environment, and things that feel comfortable. So it's important to distinguish the two different styles, okay? And when you would focus on the learning more. On the learning side, you're looking at repetition, you're looking at variability. So if you're trying to develop skills, you're trying to practice it, multi-shuttle conditioning games, different angles, under pressure, under no pressure. And you would build the mastery curve up from that in terms of increasing the cognitive kind of mental effort. And slowly over time, you'll get stability within that shot. And a nice quote at the bottom, you need to be uncomfortable in practice to be confident when it matters. So if everything's comfortable all the time, you're going to struggle to increase your level. So red line, random practice over time. If you can imagine the level of performance up at age across, as you get older, it increases the capability for players to have increased self-development, more skills to choose from, and will lead to a higher outcome compared to a blocked training, which is your consistency, no skills type of training, which will have a higher immediate impact. So if you want to have 12-year-olds, 11-year-olds who are the best in Australia, you just give them lots of fitness training, lots of drop net, corner work, maybe some games,
something that'll be good quick, but longer term, that's probably not going to have the right outcomes as somebody that's working on skills, slices, and personal development. And in the perfect world, you want a mix of both. You know, it's not one or the other. You kind of want that mix.
Do you mind if I take a photo of that?
I got one.
You
didn't stay in it.
If that helps you. Oh. It's again.
And likewise, you want to make the training as realistic as possible. So you're shooting at the target, which is easy, but then trying to shoot something that's running after you is a little bit harder. So, you know, you need to be able to make the training as match realistic as possible. So sticking with a forehand spin, you might be lots of standing still doing net shots, and then you would do it with drop shot net spin, and then you might make multi-shuttle, and then you might make your conditioned game where you're trying to focus on the net. So there might be, you know, 15 steps from one to when you can actually do it in a match competition. So you need to try and move that in the match competition as soon as possible. So in terms of that decision making, there's a number of things you can do on court and off court. So I've got a number of like handouts I'll give you to go away as well. But working in the space of the diagrams, you have all those practice types. You have match play, condition games, routines, tactical, shot training, multi-shuttle, and they all work together to produce an outcome. You've got your on-court training, and then you've got your off-court training as well. So it's really the off-court training that's key. The reflection, the question and answer with players, reviewing sessions, setting goals, motivation, question cards. So if you're going to work CC player once a week and you're going to work on a particular skill, the spin game, there might be three or four bullet points that you can put onto a nice bright colored card to give them that they can take to the training every day so they can think about it. You can work with the parents to make them aware of what you're working on. So it becomes a daily exercise. There's only so much you can do if you know once a week, once a month. So there's an example of off-court training, training between rally breaks, during rallies, all the different things you can do to try and make practice as reflective as possible. So asking, you know, players a question, changing the environment in which players are training, changing how you communicate with players during rally breaks, and how you encourage thinking off the court. Again, put a copy of this in the printout. Which then leads to the high level, which is the conditioned games where you try to bring all of that together. So within the conditioned games, you can have kind of tactical training, you can have personal skill development training, and you can have the technical skill training. Anybody doing conditioned games for each of those areas? So somebody with a conditioned game for a tactical play. Does everybody understand conditioned games in terms of setting up a practice with conditions that they can't do to achieve an outcome? So is that a conditioned game for a tactic?
Saw some yesterday. We've done some mirror practice with the other presenters.
Okay.
To a certain extent. On court.
Who's double sitting his arm?
So, to say, for every level, but it could be with kids, beginner kids, maybe they're not going to have length on the shots. So you could set up a tactical game maybe where they only score a point if they clear the back rounds. So that's a tactical game encouraging you to think about length, and then you have a discussion around why it's important to get length. You get length off serve, off lifts, off clears, different heights. You can get flat, you're going to get further, you go higher, it's going to take speed off. So it then opens up an entire discussion off the court of why you clear. So that's one game. Tactical skills, condition game. So it's a game to improve
tactical skills?
So you could do, if you want to promote flatter play, you could use like the box game or something, so you could take the front court out to get them pushing further back off the net or something.
Yep. Yep. Somebody you can't cross, struggle across blocks, block straight in the game, you could just say a game, every time you smash you have to cross block, you can't do straight blocks. So you just take that out and then they have to be practicing cross block every time. What about personal skills? So emotional control, self-awareness, self-reflection, motivation.
Playing a game that always, like, essentially just 2-point singles or something, so you're 20 all, and you've only got those 2 points, something like that.
Yep. So again, a lot of the games probably a test in their emotional control, so if you play 2 against 1, you know, that's kind of tougher than normal, and some players really struggle 2 against 1 because they can't win. The point's not about winning, it's about maybe improving the fitness element or improving the defensive element, so a lot of the games would kind of test around that area. So this model just kind of explains that cycle of, you know, there's a theme of the game, whatever it is at the top. You would engage the players in why that game is created, what they're trying to achieve. Players experience the game, normally they'll be frustrated or find it difficult. The harder the complexity, they would tend to be even more questioning. Well, this is stupid, why would they always have, you know, in a game like a straight block. There might be modifications or increases of the game to make it harder. But basically, there will be a reflective loop of the player. If they're fixed mindset, it might be stupid, from which a coach can ask for why, and then you'll get some feedback. So it kind of starts the mechanism of feedback. And the coach is always going to observe and compare with the original what they want to get out of the practice. So, the example here was low serve, for example. Game where you can only low serve. Main point being, introduces players to hitting singles, develops the return of the low serve, which is game-like. It increases an attacking style of game. It encourages tactical thinking, so why is only low serve? You're kind of restricting that they can only do certain types of shots, so therefore those shots have to be better to be able to get away with it because the opponent knows what's going to happen. It increases tension. And basically puts more pressure on them, which again, more match-like. On the outer column, it makes the players questions more, so it makes them think about when they can start low serve, like what's the advantages, what's the disadvantages. How does their opponent think? Where should they serve to? Again, the opponent will be further up the court because they know they're going to low serve, so they're under more pressure. So it makes them think about those things. Does that make sense? That's a really simple one. There's lots of. So just on this one, there's 3 tables. So there's 3 examples there, just for 2 minutes. Just want you to jot down a condition game for each of those. So on this table, you have players trying to increase their attacking capability, and in particular their cross net play. So design a game for improving their attacking capability and the cross court net. On this one, player has really good attacking shots, but makes lots of mistakes. So they want to have a condition game that builds around. Okay. And on the third one, a player struggling with the net game, so they kind of lose a lot of points in the net, and they need to develop a game to improve their net game. Just 2 minutes, just trying to jot down a few examples around that. Yes, Tom. Yes, sorry, attacking player.
Yeah.
What type of game could you do? What type of things could you do to improve their attacking capability?
So the condition period might be, you know, play the game, and if you smash and be able to move in here and follow up, you know, the return with a cross net, then you get, you know, send it off to point.
Yeah. Okay, so you increase the reward for being able to do what you want, and you make a rule that, would you say, they have to cross net after every smash?
No, they don't have to. If they win the other shot, they still get 1 point.
So increase the reward for doing that. Yeah. And if a player played the game, what kind of questions would they ask?
Well,
think a player would ask if they played that.
Play White and Four Hours.
How about, yeah, probably want more points. Would they ask, like, first thing they'd ask is why?
Yeah.
So, you know, you explain trying to improve the skill, what are you working on the area in terms of the tactical, the multi shuttle, that it's more game like. They'll probably be frustrated maybe because they try to play that shot too much and they probably make lots of mistakes. So then you probably look at what would you'd have to give them some encouragement to maybe enforce the fact that they need to get a high knee going towards the net, that they have to try and take the shuttle extra early to be in a good position. So you can basically reinforce all the technical points around the shot. You know, extra reinforce the technical point. Building the rally, so attacking.
Yeah, we went first, sort of.
No, after you.
Oh, you just posted. Minimum number of shots in a rally.
Yeah.
It's kind of looking good at that kind of rally.
Yeah, build a rally.
We also considered a variety of shots to be played before you could see if you could win a winner.
Yeah. So maybe limiting the options so that they
yeah, you can have spirited or in turn you can sit there and say, well, you want two or three shots and go for the whole selection. To get the point, ultimately he needs to hit a clear winner.
Yeah.
So actually trying to generate that space by structuring that rally.
What type of questions do you want to pose?
The obvious one was, why am I doing this? probably what shots can I use, which are my weak shots.
And maybe by doing the exercise it's probably going to be quite hard for you, you know, because the rallies are longer.
Yeah.
So there might be, you know, assumptions on their behalf of trying to change it because it's hard. So I'm trying to explain the benefits, trying to explain what's going on and how it makes it. Last one was net, so trying to improve the net game.
One of the things to isolate, highlight the problems or the issues that they're both have, and isolating it to a single word or maybe a single movement and all that to correct that issue that they had before introducing, for example, with a net game there, you can move to left and right, and problems mainly with the back end, concentrate on the back end and come back and see if that improves and what we wanted beforehand.
So again, assumption on my behalf and a prerequisite that they follow those lower the basic building of that technique possible net shots. So they've done that in advance. So you're saying basically a game that limits, so maybe like a net game situation.
Rewards as well, you know, if you win up the net shot then you get extra points for example, and then you also question the players whether when would you do this net shot to get that advantage. Players for example would call it before you do a net shot. This one on the players at the back might be a higher advantage point.
What do you think with condition games, so you've got more restrictive games like this, and then you've got more physical condition games like yours, and then you have more games in between that are game-like, that have skill. What generally do you think players' reactions are to those games at every level? Do they go, it's great, let's do more condition games, or do they go,
huge
amount
of noise.
Yeah.
Huge frustration.
Okay. So why is that?
Because they're restricted.
Get out of their comfort zone.
Yeah.
And yeah, so some players, I think, if they see the benefit for them, they're a lot more willing, which I guess comes back to growth and fixed mindsets about fixed, or I only ever play a game with no restrictions, why would I bother doing anything other, versus the benefits that they can achieve having a focus.
So the recognition that there's going to be a pushback probably, because they don't understand the pool of information is quite small, they don't understand why, there's lots of assumptions on their part. So again, part of the coaching process is giving them the background, explaining and engaging with them. So just an array. So up is attacking, down is defensive. Then you've got like mentally challenging and physically challenging. So you can see a lot of the exercises, these are just examples, they tend to err on the mentally challenging rather than the physically challenging. So a game like yours would be probably, I think, number 14. Like Dog Master number 14 is where one player plays a shot and the other one follows and just gets it back. So the one player can maybe choose straight or cross, and then the other player can only play straight. And they're trying to have a build around type session like yours. Where, say, number 21, which is on the mental side, is which is just purely mental, maybe awful. So they're heavily involved in the mental side of stuff, physically less demanding. So up front, before you go into that space, it's important to try and communicate that to the place and explain the importance of that area, but explain this area is physically less demanding, but it's equally as important for them and their development. This is a similar scenario where you have all the areas that a player maybe wants to work on, and then you have a list of, so 1 to 22 are different types of games, and what they, which ones you work in which area. And the list goes on, so open-ended in the number of games. But again, as a tool resource, if you're managing coaches, you can give them the skills to be able to work on particular skill sets. Again, back to the Danish system, they do an awful lot of condition games. When I trained at the National Centre of Rugby for 3 or 4 years, and it was a little bit frustrating to say, because I came from a background of blocked training, where I didn't do much below the line thinking. I came from above the line thinking, lots of running on the beach, because there's not many coaches in Wales, there's no players in Wales, so I focused on things I could control. So then going to Denmark to train, where it was like below the line all the time, was very frustrating. So they would do a lot of games where reflection games, so whatever somebody played, you have to play the opposite. So somebody did a straight play, you have to play a cross play. Somebody did a cross block, you have to play a boost. So, but basically, probably 40% of the training was like that, and it was mentally quite tough. And at that time, I used to train with Paul Eric Pilos, who was Olympic champion, and coming to an end. So I would train with him, he was a friend, and basically nearly all the training I did with him was reflective condition game training. Now, partly that's because if you played one-on-one, you came, and it made the training a bit hard for him. But nearly all the training we did was reflective condition game type of training. So, you know, he had excellent technique, he had lots of winning shots, he didn't get many injuries, so his fitness was good. So he spent a lot of time on the tactical ability, so that when he played a Chinese opponent, an Indian opponent, he could really execute the skills and the tactics perfectly. So, again, the Danish system's a really good example of that use of that below-the-line reflective training. And they take it as a prerequisite, an assumption, that you have the physical presence. Like, that's just, they don't really work on physical training in the national football. It's a prerequisite that you have that, but they work a lot on the technical. And because of the strength of the system, the players are technically good going in, so then they focus a lot on the tactical and the mental side. So, in condition games, mentally challenging, can be physically challenging. A lot of player discussion, a lot of self-improvement, and very game-like. So, with Paul Eric example, they were very game-like for him, because he was playing Dong Zhong or specific players, and he would set the game up. I could keep the shuttle in, and I could hit it hard, and I didn't make mistakes. So he would set the training up so that he would get the most